A 9-point week sees Atlanta United rise all the way to 5th in the Eastern Conference, but they did look a little leggy at the end of that game against Orlando. What kind of side will Frank De Boer put out against Vancouver? Find out next.
What's going on, Five Sharp fam? I'm AJ, this is Tanner McLeod. Before we get into it, become a member of the notification squad by hitting the bell next to the subscribe button on YouTube or hop over from Facebook and subscribe.
You can now also find all our content on the Jinico USA platform anywhere in the world, on Amazon Fire TV, Roku, iOS, Google Play, and many other streaming platforms.
Welcome to a match preview special. We'll have the Orlando City match review later on this week on Five Stripe Weekly. But first up is the Vancouver Whitecaps match on Wednesday. And yeah, I mean, BC Place, 10 p.m. It's gonna be another late one. And yeah, the cross-country travel that the team has to do.
This next week is stupid.
Yeah, this is just absolutely ridiculous.
So if you didn't know, they have to go all the way out to Vancouver, which is what we're about to break down now, but then they have to come back to play Red Bulls, only to go back across the country and play in Salt Lake City against Real Salt Lake in a week. That's smart, MLS. Thanks. But first up is that task against the Vancouver Whitecaps, a team that we have split both games with in the first two seasons in the first three meetings. Took a bit of a pasting first year round up in Vancouver, a 3-1 defeat.
Where Greg Garza had that sweet goal on the back post, did the Ronaldo celebration, and then we got housed. Yeah, we got shipped three goals.
That being said, we returned the favor with the 4-1 pasting last season that saw Kendall Waston see red. We all enjoyed that one because he was very confused at the time.
Which he was clapping. I think Jeff Lorenowitz,
Yeah, he thought someone else got sent off and was like, fam, it's you. You gone.
Yeah.
But right now, and getting into this one, Atlanta United comes into this on very good form. 4 wins in a row, 5 out of 6, and 4 clean sheets to boot. Things are going pretty well for the Five Stripes right now.
Right, but for Vancouver Whitecaps, not as bad actually as we think they might be in terms of where they are in the standings. But they have 2 wins in their last 4, which is not bad. I mean, so they've risen up in the standings after kind of a pretty iffy start, just like ours in the beginning of the season.
Those 2 wins, one was a 3-2 win over a 10-man Colorado Rapids, and the other was a 1-0 against Portland Timbers, who, as of yet, I think still are kind of stuttering a bit themselves at this season. Still a nice win for them, don't get me wrong, but it's not as if they've been thoroughly convincing. And that 3-2 win against Colorado was definitely more of an aberration rather than the norm, because this team struggles to score goals. Mm-hmm. Where have we heard that before?
But, in terms of this, they're a team that, which is really, really interesting to see, like on who scored anyway. You kind of look at them and it says, they have no significant strengths.
Yeah.
So
things Toronto's, Vancouver's good at. Nothing
much to note of, but in terms of their weaknesses, they have quite a bit of things, and so that's very interesting. I mean, I think they are still a team that, plays big and tall and, maybe tries to go Route 1, which, it's not dissimilar to what we're used to playing, especially on the road. But I think, without a Kendall Waston, it kind of makes them a little less dangerous maybe in that regard. But they still have some guys that are, some danger men. But I think, in terms of some more weaknesses that they have, some of those, defending the set pieces is something that, if we have a PT in the game, we have Miles, we have an LGP, we have a Jeff Lorenowitz, one of these days, some of these set pieces are going to come off, right?
Absolutely. I mean, it's like, if there was a match where you could maybe get something done on a set piece, this could be the one. Mm-hmm. I mean, when was the last time Atlanta United scored directly off a set piece? Yeah. Pitties had that free kick 2 games ago. They got hit, the keeper saved it, and then it got crossed back in, but that's not directly off of it. When was the last time
Atlanta
United scored
one,
off of a corner?
Well, yeah, the most memorable set piece one was still from the MLS Cup, where, you had Gressel and Miggy over it, and then,
flicked on ball, and then, exactly. But aside from that, this team isn't renowned for being a strong set-piece team. The one thing, though, that Vancouver struggles with that I look at is avoiding individual errors, and this is something that has led to a lot of goals that they've conceded so far this year is that when some of their defenders are put under pressure, they do fail to cope with that sometimes. So the likes of a Tito Villalba, a PT Martinez who is on form, even perhaps a Justin Miram, a Joseph Martinez, if they put this team under pressure, they will have the chance to score goals. And as we've seen with Atlanta United, they've been creating opportunities. Mm-hmm. They've been creating chances. They just haven't been able to put them away.
Right.
You're going on the road. They've won two in a row, so they're going to want to come out and get a result. So hopefully Vancouver will play a bit more open, and if they do that, that'll play right into Atlanta United's hands.
Right. And so also, I mean, it's something that they tend to do is they rotate their starting 11 a lot. So it might be really just, you know, up in the air who actually is going to start on this Wednesday, as much as we might rotate this match, they might as well, and who knows if they're going to do almost even a line change, or like, you know, two or three in each line. I mean, who knows? But
I think predicting the starting 11s for this match is going to be very difficult, because with all these, you know, midweek fixtures happening this month, teams have to rotate, teams have to take care of their squads. Normally, if they didn't have to rotate, I would be a lot more concerned about this match, because I believe Atlanta United will, and they already have said that they will rest a few players, and some players will not make the trip. Mm-hmm. But
we'll get into that.
Yeah, we'll get into that in our the injury report. But I think what's interesting is that Atlanta United has the better players. They have more talent. Mm-hmm. They should take care of business here. But again, can they continue to keep clean sheets, and can they start taking those chances when they have the opportunities? And that's been the one criticism you could say of this four-match win streak, is that aside from SKC, where you had some great finishes from Barco and Martinez, this team lets chances go begging. And if you do that on the road, you might get punished for it.
Exactly. I mean, we've played 10 matches in MLS, and we've scored 12. I mean, that's not a spectacular return. And so, yeah, it's something that we absolutely need to get better at. This is a team that is susceptible to a team that can really create a lot of chances. Lately, we've been doing that, and it's definitely been more entertaining, but it's, you know, high time now to really see these players hit the back of the net, especially against maybe another rotated side, and maybe not as much for us. Especially if a Joseph starts, then, you know, I fancy him versus a rotated side. So that's
but
for sure.
One of the interesting things about goals in this match is that there's been under 2.5 goals scored in 10 of Atlanta United's last 12 games, and there's been under 2.5 goals scored in each of Vancouver's last 5 home games. So the stats would say that there's not going to be a lot of goals in this match. So the team that can get them, or can get one, might put themselves in pole position to get 3 points.
Exactly. And yeah, it's super imperative for Atlanta to score first. And, you know, as we've said before, and as, you know, football tends to say, if you score first, you kind of have the general way of probably winning the match.
And I think this is more one of those matches, more so than others, where a goal might be enough to see you live, take all 3 points away from this
match. Especially, you know, with the jaded factor that it's kind of
real. Both sides are going to be, you know, having to deal with.
So some players to watch for Vancouver Whitecaps. You, of course, have Freddie Montero, 31 years old now. 3 goals, 1 assist so far in 10 appearances. And he's scored in 2 consecutive matches, like you've said. But, you know, you have kind of an, you know, another thing where, you know, where are the other creation, you know, points going to come from? It's really, you know, you have guys with 1 assist here and there. They just...
Well, their second leading scorer is Daniel Henry, who's a central defender, and he has 2 goals.
Right.
And he's, like, strong in the air, and that's pretty much his MMO. And, I mean, aside from that, Ali Adnan at left back, but he's got a rick in him as well. He's had errors that have led to goals so far this season. He can contribute both ways, and he's good at reading the game out. But again, he is liable to make a mistake. There's not a lot of attacking quality in this team. And, I mean, not to be negative on him or anything, this was a team Breck Shea was starting for last season. So it's not necessarily that they've been strong, and he was one of their key players to a degree in terms of going forward. So this team has lost players. They've lost to Kendall Waston, who's gone to Cincinnati, and they haven't really reloaded a lot. So they're not a team that screams at you, dangerous opponent, but because of that, that might be why this is a difficult match for Atlanta United, because in MLS, that you can easily see teams beating teams where it makes no sense whatsoever.
This is a trap game. If there was a definition, this is a trap game.
After Orlando and before Red Bulls.
Yeah. And so, you know, you have the expectation of, okay, we're on a 4-match winning streak. You know, it's something that you definitely need to really be weary of. And also, you know, looking at their injury report, you know, you have guys like a Jordi Reyna, who's a guy who is a forward that historically has been one of their better players, out for them as well. So their tendency to sit back, this might be even just epic levels of possession, epic levels of low block, slashing the tires, just absolutely parking that bus right in front of that box, or in the box even. But yeah, and in terms of Atlanta United, our injuries and suspensions and whatnot, we don't have any suspensions recently. But yeah, we have George Bella, of course, out long term. Kevin Kratz has returned to training, but I think it has been said that he will probably be getting back to the actual fitness in about a couple of weeks. That's according to Felipe Cardenas of The Athletic. And Nagby and Parkey are going to be rested and will not make the trip. And they haven't, you know, on the social medias, they definitely have been shown where they're not there. So that makes it for a very interesting, prospects for this match. So the keys to this game, what do you think they're going to be?
For me, I think it's, can Atlanta United continue to build off the positive momentum they've had going forward and turn those chances that they've created into goals? If they can take those chances and turn them into goals, they will beat Vancouver Whitecaps. It is as simple as that. They are a better team. They just have to be clinical. And if they can get two goals, I see no way that Vancouver Whitecaps manages to get any sort of result in this game, because Atlanta United have been so good defensively. And by getting those goals, if you can be in control, it allows you to rotate some more and bring some players in and allow us to get those substitutes on earlier into the match if you have that two-goal advantage, which then makes your team even more fresh for Red Bull's match this weekend.
Yeah, and I think that's what's going to be really, really difficult, though, is how are we going to cope with that cross-country travel, and how much rotation is going to be necessary. And I think that plays right into what our predicted starting 11 is going to be. And I think let's kind of go through line by line, and let's see if we agree. But of course, Guzan, who had a hell of a match saving goals in this previous match
against Orlando, but yeah, he was definitely a bit susceptible on the ball.
Yeah, exactly. He was
some questionable decisions.
Very, very. It made me very weary of
the one like save where he threw it back in after the back header, and it was like, bro, what are you doing?
Yeah, it almost cost us a couple of times, but yes, of course, Guzan is still between the sticks. Just kind of limit those errors, please. But because against a more clinical team, this is not the clinical team that would do it, but you never know.
In terms of defense, I think you and I pretty much agree all the way across on this. We have Escobar at right back, Robinson, LGP, and Breck Shea. I think in terms of changes you could see there, Shea obviously will start at left back because you have Parkhurst being rested. I think the interesting part there would be whether or not you see Pogba step.
Yeah, exactly. I think there's a lot of people pining for a Florentine Pogba, and I think it still might be too early. I don't think he's, having played a lot of Atlanta United 2 matches even, where he plays a full 90, and it's just a matter of it really needing to be, meaningful minutes. And this could be that match, but I mean, with a four, straight win kind of streak on the line, is this the match that we see him, come in? I don't know. I don't think this is that type of match for him, but I think he could spell one of the guys later on, or come on and have a three center back look. So it very well could where he does get a run out. Now in terms of the midfield, I think there's only two guys that are,
if one's being left behind, there's only two to pick from.
Exactly, and I think kind of has some bearing on who might be the backup for all of that. But I think it's Larry and Rometty in the middle, and you're gonna have to rely on Rometty to kind of do a little bit of what Nagby does. But I think it's a little bit easier when you have a team that's probably gonna sit back a little bit more, and that's what I think the attacking midfielders are. It's gonna be super important for them to be able to not only keep possession but create from those positions. And so getting into that. For me, I think it's going to be, since Tito, PT, and Gressel were rested. I think Gressel...
Were
subbed last match. And so I think Gressel is going to be rested for this because he's the other viable central midfielder that has experience. And, you know, he might come on later to spell one of those guys. And so that makes that attacking triumvirate, at least in midfield, I think Tito on the right, PT in the middle, of course, because I think you need this type of guy that can hold on to possession and create and, you know, just do everything that PT does. And I think this is where it's interesting. It could be a Pereira or a Miram. I think Pereira has shown, trained with the team a lot more. So I think I favor a Pereira in this instance, and maybe Miram kind of subs in for him in the second half. But that's my attacking driver.
For me, I have Gressel on the right just because I think his fitness and his work rate is pretty good and he'll still be there. And I think that you can sub him off later in the match to bring on a Pereira, mm-hmm. or you can even drop him into the midfield if you need to take off a Rometty. Mm-hmm. But for me, his work rate and his fitness seem to be pretty high, so I can see him starting on the right. I agree with you, PT in the middle. And then I have Justin Miram on the left. He is more experienced in MLS. He's, from what we've been told, comfortable in this sort of system, although he hasn't trained a lot with the team. He looked decent in the few minutes he was on mm-hmm. against Orlando, although very small sample size. But I think that this could be a game where you want to go with that experience. And if you feel comfortable with Justin Miram and his ability, then I would have him playing over a Dion Pereira only because of that experience mm-hmm. in Major League Soccer. So I have Miram on the left there, and I think Pereira will play in this game, and I think he will come off the bench at some point in time for someone in that midfield three. And then getting the forward, I think we both agree that it's Joseph, although I'd like to see him subbed off if possible in this game.
Maybe like a 60-minute sub, probably not so early because Frank de Boer probably doesn't usually do that. So, but I mean, for me and my likeness of what he would want to do, yes, that would be that. But on the bench, I think seeing the likes of John Gallagher travel, I think he's going to be maybe that... that substitute maybe for Escobar if, if something happens to him.
Or if you need to play a back three and Escobar's playing as a center back, you can put him as a right wing back.
So. Exactly. You get options there. You also have Carlton made the trip as well. I think Williams also, Romario Williams, is probably going to kind of maybe feature because if Joseph comes off, you know, it's either Tito or Romario, right? So anyway, so to get to that score prediction, what do you think?
Well, before we get into the score prediction, I'll drop you the odds real quickly. Atlanta United to win are 11-10 or 47.62% chance. The draw is 13-5, which is 27.78% chance. And for Vancouver to win, it is at 11-5, which is a 31.25% chance. Those odds are via Bet365. Mm-hmm. So with that being said, getting into my prediction for me, I'm going to say 2-0 Atlanta United. I think that they're a better team. I think that even with a bit of rotation, they have more than enough talent on the attacking end, and they've been solid enough defensively. My only question would be how the middle of the park will cope with some of this running around. But if Vancouver sit deep, I think that Jeff Lorenz will be able to control the game. Mm-hmm. I think you will see Rometty subbed off at some point in time, but I still think they're much better than Vancouver. They've gotten a good run going so far. Uh-huh. 2-0 against a team that struggles to score. Mm-hmm. 5 wins in a row, 5 clean sheets in a row, onto New York Red Bull.
Yeah, okay. I hope it's a 2-0. I think it's going to be a little bit more of a trap game than I want it to be. And so I'm going to go against the odds, and I'm going to say it's a 1-1 draw. At least it's not the alternative, which this looks like it could be like a 0-0 draw, which is a slog,
especially if it's a 10 o'clock game and it's over by midnight. Exactly. And everyone wants to sleep if you haven't been put asleep already by 0-0 football.
And so I hope it's definitely not at all. I hope there are goals in this, and at least a 1-1, at least that makes us undefeated in our last 5. Not the most convincing, of course, then, but I think it's really about surviving this week for the 5 Stripes. But that's our match preview, and let us know what your score predictions are in the comments below. But remember to subscribe if you haven't already. Smash that like button and share this video because it really does help us a lot. And for Tanner McLeod, I'm AJ. Thank you guys so much for watching.